to go first.
And you can address to an individual or to the whole panel, however you think.
Okay, Nicole, I was wondering what some of the sources you used for like the past year.
Most of my sources come from the CDC, the Center for Disease Control, the American Academy of Pediatrics, the World Health Organization, the National Institute for Preventive Medicine, I think. So all of the sources that I used were credited and typically revolving around some sort of either government or world organization, since the doctors were credible. I also used a lot from Dr. Sears, who is sort of a celebrity doctor, and typically I caution that celebrity doctors that go by their first names are not always someone that you want to take at face value. But Dr. Sears, who is a figurehead in the attachment parenting community, advocates a delayed vaccination schedule. He's an older gentleman, so he says that a lot of the younger parents that aren't vaccinating right now haven't seen the effects of mumps, measles, rubella, whooping cough, pertussis, which is whooping cough. So he advocates that even though there are these chemicals and things, that you want to keep vaccinating. So, sorry, I kind of went off on a tangent there. Yeah, but all of my sources are doctor or government related.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Who's next?
For Nicole, I was just wondering, do you think that there should be an opt-out clause for people who just maybe could stand to take vaccines but just don't have they don't believe in it because of religion or some other cause?
You know, absolutely, and very much to each their own, but in general, when we have these large portions of people who aren't doing it based on so little research and so nothing really founded, it becomes dangerous. Like, if you read about it in India, they're very culturally against vaccines, and I'm not going to advocate changing your entire lifestyle and your entire belief system, because that's intrusive, and that's not what I'm about. But I think that if people were fully educated and they knew the repercussions, the chances of them opting out would be lessened. If they have a legitimate reason for not wanting to vaccinate their child, I'm not going to control them. That's on them, you know? I mean, but I think that the anti-vaccine movement is less culturally based anymore and more based on the hysteria and the media. Mm-hmm. Does that kind of answer your question? Okay.
Actually, piggybacking on something you just said, I have a question for all three of you. I think that I'm going to misquote you, but you said something about information. And so the thing that kept striking me as all of you were presenting is that, wow, when you're really informed about something, you can make a much better decision. And it sounds so cliche and stupid to say that out loud. Well, of course, that's true. But I think we have such busy lives that we don't get super informed. We don't get that deeper information. And so, yeah, again, that struck me with each of your presentations. Like, I feel like, wow, I know about what Hep B does and is on a cellular level. It's incredible to me. And so the question I have for you based on that is, you know, we have this sort of culture of alternative medicine, non-traditional medicine versus traditional medicine. But what I'm seeing is a spectrum instead of a sort of either or developing over the course of all three of your talks, that if you're informed, any sort of approach to illness or medicine can be a smart approach or something used. And so I'm wondering if you guys would like to respond individually to this idea of there being a spectrum instead of a combat situation between the two based on having good information versus just sort of flying off half-cocked, you know, with regular medicine or non-traditional, either one.
Thank you. I really like that question. And I think I said I am not against the psychotherapy and the drugs that are prescribed. I think that's great. In addition, we can be looking at integrated therapies, different things that come from other realms that may help and may have less side effects. I'd love to see medicine integrated from all aspects. A lot of times our medicine right now is just focused on getting rid of a symptom. Getting rid of the symptom might not get rid of the cause and the holistic medicine that I've been learning in the past 2 years is more focused on looking at the whole person and getting down to a cause. And one of the problems with that in our society is people want an instant fix. So if you're given a drug that gets rid of the symptom in a couple of days, that's a little bit sooner maybe than working through psychotherapy and diet, getting better exercise and all those things that are gonna make you as a whole person healthier. And it does, it takes a little bit longer, but I believe it gets to the root of the problem. So maybe a mix of both things would be fantastic. And when you have hepatitis C, I would say do whatever your doctor says to get rid of it, because that's serious stuff. Thank you.
Well, as you're passing the mic, I'll just use this as a plug for the, there's a really terrific program we have here at Red Rocks for holistic health. Is anybody else involved in that program in the room right now? From every student I've ever had in my own English classes, I teach English here, who's also been a part of that program, has had nothing but amazing things to say about taking part in those classes. And again, it's not a program that's at odds with Western medicine. It's a program that's meant to go along with and augment and be another path to health and healing. So, yeah.
I fully agree with what you've stated. I think you stated it beautifully. I find that when we have hot button issues, such as vaccines, people take a very militant approach one way or another. And we don't really have a middle ground. And I don't think Western medicine and alternative medicine should be pitted against each other. As a culture, we strongly over-medicate. We throw antibiotics at things that don't necessarily need antibiotics, like colds and flu. So I think that holistic medicine has its merits. I don't like to give medicine to my child if she doesn't 100% need it. I don't give ibuprofen for every fever. That's not good for the body, you know. Whereas if she's got a cough, maybe I'll give her some honey, which is more of a holistic remedy. So they really do have opportunities to work hand in hand with each other. And by eliminating like the over-medication and using some of the self-healing remedies, we could be healthier as a culture. I definitely don't think we need any militant, extremist, warring medicine. It's not good for anybody involved.
Fevers. If you're not careful with fevers, they can cause them to go sterile. Children.
Oh, right. They get too high. Yeah, yeah.
I'm speaking more like low grade fevers. So she's running at 100.1 because she's teething, and there's just that's a fever is a sign that there's something going on in the body and your body's fighting it. So if she gets over the threshold of safety, I immediately call her doctor. If her fever's persistent, I give her ibuprofen as such. We just try to use judgment calls so we're not
over-medicating.
Does that make sense?
Okay, go ahead.
So I agree, but I'm just also going to say my background is Western medicine, studying pre-med, studying biology, studying chemistry. I was kind of ingrained with that Western medicine background and knowledge. I've worked in a pharmacy for 5 years, so I have a big pharmaceutical background, and I currently work in a doctor's office where we're pretty traditional. But I do agree with holistic therapies. I think we never want to immediately over-medicate. We don't want to immediately go to surgery. I think there's other things that as well can be done. And I think that's where a relationship with your doctor or your primary doctor, your specialist really is important. You want to have trust. You want to have communication. You want to be your own advocate in the end. You know, because as medical providers, we should be educated on both traditional medicine and the holistic alternative therapies. You know, while doing my undergrad, I took a course specifically on current topics in medical research, and a lot of our discussions and arguments were on traditional versus holistic. And I think as medical providers, we need to be educated and aware of both, because our patients are coming in. A lot of our patients are at their wit's end. You know, I'll try this, I'll try anything, and it's our responsibility to be educated so we can give them good, sound medical advice to say, I recommend this, I don't recommend this, because ultimately it's our job to have their safety. Mm-hmm. And I just think it's important to have that relationship and be open and honest about any alternative therapies with your providers, because they're there to be your advocate, they're there to help you with everything. So I think that's just the main thing. Not to put one against the other, but just to be fully educated on both and have an open, honest communication with both. I know sometimes you talk to holistic providers and they're like, oh, Western medicine, like, don't talk to them. And there's a big battle and there's a secrecy sometimes between traditional and holistic providers. So I think we need to have that open communication, because ultimately it's not a battle between what type, it's how we can successfully mm-hmm. treat our patient.
Well, I think at last year's conference, there was another medical panel, but it was all from the humanistic side. It was three people presenting on some rather emotional topics related to medicine, and it just so happens that the PA program decided one of the classes, the entire class came in to listen, and one of the comments during last year's conference that it was like the highlight of the whole conference for me is this girl stood up and she said, you know, I've been studying all this Western medicine and the facts and the statistics and the figures, and she said, this might have been one of the most valuable moments of my career in studying medicine so far, because I have a lot more context now for all this information I've been gathering. And I do think that now schools, programs are starting to bring more of the holistic health, the whole person perspective into medicine, and looking at things that have solid information behind them, such as aromatherapy. There's solid research that shows the effects of aromatherapy, as opposed to something more controversial, and I hope I don't get anybody pissed off at me here, but like the homeopathy, right? Is that the right thing, you know? But anyway, you know, and so we have, again, another spectrum of whether people believe in that or don't believe in that, but there's information that backs things, you know, and so I like knowing that modern medicine is paying more attention to some of this stuff. Does somebody else have another comment or question for the panel? I'll bring you the mic. And any comment would be appreciated too, even if it's just telling them what a fantastic job they did presenting, which they did, by the way.
Is it Deborah? This is for you, Deborah. I'm sorry it doesn't read. We have a lot of vets here at Red Rocks. And a couple of them have talked to me about how the VA treats them, et cetera. So I'm curious about, I totally believe in aromatherapy, but I can't always afford the purest essential oils in a bottle. So I don't know how your nephew did this, but how can vets pay for this? Because a lot of them have, you know, it's not covered by the VA, and it can be costly. I'm speaking immediately. So my question is immediately, how can they?
Can I add to that question? That's a really good question, and it leads into something else I wanted to ask about, which is, you mentioned the quality of the oils. Just actually, I've noticed in my own life with my daughter that I had some fake lavendery thing that really was having no effect whatsoever, you know, and I got her a doll that was filled with real lavender, and it's amazing to watch what that does when you lay that on her chest. And so I've seen that. I mean, she's 9 months old. She's not on the pro or con side of this. She's not trying to prove a point. She's just having a real reaction. But how important is it that it be real, this, or what are the, like you said, you were going to go maybe go into the levels of quality. So yeah, I think that's related to what you asked, right, too. Yeah, how would they pay for this higher quality stuff, not the $2 stuff off the shelf that I tried to start with?
Thank you for reminding me, because I didn't really go into that. I am not a big fan of the multi-level marketing companies, and also another thing I didn't go into, I think, was about taking it internally, because the multi-level marketing companies will tell you to do that, and I absolutely disagree with that 100%. I would never take them internally. So you did not hear that from me. You just mentioned a pillow filled with lavender, and as you were saying that, I was thinking, well, I have lavender plants growing in my garden. So one way to make, at least for the lavender, to make it more affordable is grow your own. And it is effective. When you're using the lavender plant itself, that is not the distilled essential oil, but it definitely has the effects. And there are several different aromatherapy type plants that we can grow here in Colorado. I also have lemon balm in my garden.
Would you be willing to partner with the vet center? Maybe we could plant some here for use. Wouldn't that be an amazing idea?
That would be awesome.
All we got to do is tell the president we want a little plot of land for it, right?
Oh, that would be awesome, because I'm all about wanting the vets to be able to afford it, and everyone to be able to afford it also. I know that is a problem, and I don't in my practice, from when I go out and practice, I am going to make it as affordable as possible for people. So we could talk about alternative ways. There are places online that you can get it for pretty good quality for a little bit less. A lot of times you buy in quantity too. Of course, that means upfront a little bit of money.
Thank you very much, and that's your next resume builder right there for your career. Let's get that going for the vets here. Any other comments or questions? Okay, let's thank the presenters one more time, and you did an incredible job, everybody. We are going to be here tomorrow, again, 3 sessions, and so you can talk to me after if you want a complete topic listing. One of the things that's going to happen is a history-themed panel with some visual analysis of key photos from history. I know George is a big history fan, so maybe we'll see you back for that tomorrow. And otherwise, feel free to pick up a free edition of Claro, the school scholarly journal, where a lot of this scholarship, well, all the scholarship comes from, is over there. Everybody is welcome to take one. We've also got some pads and pens over there. Hope to see you back tomorrow, and thanks so much for coming.